Magandang araw mga kapamilya. Welcome to Journeys of Hope. This weekend we have a very special guest, no? And I will let him share his story with you. But just a quick background, I work with him in Caritas Philippines, no? Because he is the representative here and actually representative of Caritas Espanola here in the Philippines and also for the Asian region. No? And he's been here in the Philippines for, I think if I'm not mistaken, for close to 6 years. No? And I will let him share his story. So I would like to welcome to our this weekend's episode of Journeys of Hope. We'd like to welcome David Munoz, Quiroz, Quiroz. Hi, David. Welcome and thank you for joining us.
Hello, Father. Thanks to you. Good day. And yes, it's an honor to be here and to be part of this season where you have the chance to meet people. No, that is very nice to be part of it. Thank you very much for inviting me.
No, thank you for joining. Of course, as I mentioned, you are now with Caritas Espanola, but I think they should hear your journey, how you got to Caritas Espanola, no? Because very, very interesting journey of, I guess, discovering, no, where you would feel most, not just productive, but more meaningful work, no, real life of purpose and mission. So maybe you could share your story with them, David.
Yeah, actually, it has been a very long journey to be here. It hasn't been easy because, let's see, this is like my dream job since I was young, and to reach this point hasn't been easy. So, as you well said, currently I'm the delegate person of Caritas Spain in the Asia region, but I'm based on the Philippines. But we have projects also like in India, Bangladesh, Nepal, Cambodia, and different areas of Asia, so it's a very demanding work.
Mm-hmm. And prior to that, you had spent two three years right here in the Philippines with another NGO prior to working with Caritas Española.
That's right. I was first based in Lagonoy, which is a very remote area of the Philippines, and I was there for more than a year and a half. And then I moved to Naga City, where I was working with Caritas Cáceres for another year and a half. So in total, I was there 3 years.
In the Bicol region.
In the Bicol region, yes. Yeah. And then I started working with Caritas Spain. And that was the time when I moved to Manila. So in Manila, actually, I'm like around a year. So in total, in the Philippines, I've been around 4 years. And I also been here during the pandemic, so good hard times.
Yeah. And but prior to that, your work was not in development work, right? Prior to that, because as you had mentioned in our conversation, you first did a business course in college.
Yeah, that's totally fine. Actually, I studied psychology, so I'm psychologist background studies. Mm-hmm. And I also have social work. Okay. During my years of social work and psychologist, I spent also 2 years in Germany. So okay. It was a great experience for me because I kind of mixed my studies in between Spain and Germany. It gave me a very good background in psychologist and social work.
Social
and
work.
Really great experience. Actually, the first time I went to Germany, I was 19 years old. I couldn't speak any word of English or German. So it was a very, very hard experience what I had there. But luckily, I was surrounded of very nice people who were very patient with me and I could work with them. I learned a lot from them and I have a very, very good experience in my life in Germany.
Yeah, and then you spent some time in London, right?
That's right. Actually, when I finished my studies, I really wanted to work in social work because I think since I'm young, I've been always moved by injustice, you know? So I've really been like a person who really wanted to work in social work to try to make the difference or try to, you know, these dreams that you have when you're young that you're going to make the world a better place by making OGIF. So I had all of that in my mind. But But when I finished my studies, it was around 2008, and it was the big. There was a big crisis, a big crisis in Europe, and it affected several countries around the world. So it was very difficult at that time to find a job. So it wasn't that easy for me to start my work in the social field as I wanted. So I had to go to the easy way, which was business and human resources. I moved to London first because when I finished my studies in psychology, I was fluent in German, but I couldn't speak a word of English. So I really, whenever I was starting looking for a job, everyone was asking like, yeah, it's very nice you speak German, but if you don't speak English, you're not going to go anywhere. So I thought, okay, let's just go to London. That's going to be the best thing I can do, just to start learning. And I was very lucky because I when I was looking for jobs, of course, my strong point is Spanish, no? When I was in the UK, so I was working for jobs where they were looking for Spanish speakers. Yeah. And I was very lucky because there was a private company who was looking for a consultant to open business in Latin America. It was very funny because actually during our interview, we couldn't really understand each other, but I think they saw something of me that they thought it may work. They finally hired me, and I was working with them for 2 years, opening business in Latin America for an IT consultancy. So I was really totally out of my studies or of my area of interest. But it was more on personal development, no? Because it gave me a very good skills that I've been able to use in my life. Of course, it gave me the English that I used for the rest of my life. It was a very nice experience, actually, my life in London. A little bit cloudy all the time, so missing the sun.
But during your stint in London, did that require you to travel to Latin America?
No, it was all remote work. It was not needed to go to Latin America. So all the work was remotely.
But of course, so you spent 2 years. 2 years in London, right?
I spent a little bit more, like 2 years and some months, and I was already looking for an opportunity to start my work in international cooperation and social field work. So I got a chance to work in Nicaragua with an NGO from England named Progresio. Okay. So I made the interviews and everything, and I was selected as a team leader. So I was so happy because it would be my first step to start working in the field.
Your field, no? Okay.
Exactly. And that was the time when I was sent to Masaya, like a very small town in the middle Nicaragua in Central America, and there is where I started developing my professional career in international cooperation. I finally was there like almost a year in Nicaragua, and actually, Father, I was so in love of Central America that I decided that I really wanted to learn more. I really wanted to know more about Latin America. And I always had this dream, you know, that sometimes you have that you want to cross the world, you want to travel around, you want to just... So I said, you know, this is if I want to do something like that, it has to be now. So okay. I made my bag, and I went to Mexico, and I started traveling as a backpacker for 1 year to the north, to the south of Latin America.
That was one whole year,
almost a year. Yeah, it was actually 10 months, and it was.
And you were telling me, David, that literally you just had a backpack, literally no other luggage, right?
Nothing else, just a backpack, a 40 liters backpack, and that was all. And I was very afraid at the beginning because it was like it's not something that people do around you, you know. Especially I'm coming from a small town in Spain. My family is from the same town. So for them, they couldn't understand what I was doing. At some point, I couldn't understand also myself, but I felt it was something I had to do because I thought, you know, if I want to work in the social field, Latin America is a country that is facing a lot of poverty and needs.
And I thought
I can just cross Latin America looking for social organizations that are looking for volunteers, and I can just go through those agents organization in order to support them with my skills, with my knowledge. And I was only asking for accommodation and meals in return.
Yeah.
So I met amazing people in all the countries, in Mexico, in Guatemala, in Honduras, Costa Rica, Colombia, Peru, Bolivia, Chile, wow. Argentina, Brazil. I was in all those countries.
So what? How many countries in total? How many countries did you?
Total it was 9 countries.
9 countries, okay. Okay, so roughly a month each, you know, in the countries, yeah.
Exactly, it was like around a month per country. So it was an incredible experience. I learned a lot. People in Latin America are amazing. I gave everything I could. They gave me everything they could. It was a life experience, totally a life experience.
How was the arrangement there? So you would contact them ahead of time, no?
I was using websites. I was using Workaway. I was using Couchsurfing. I was using different kind of websites. And also, you know, when you're traveling as a backpacker in any place around the world, you meet other backpackers. And whenever you meet them, some of them are going down, others are going up, others are around the country, but you always get advices from them. So whenever I meet other backpackers around in other countries, they just give me advices on where to go, what to do, what people to meet. So it was pretty nice. It was pretty nice. So it was.
Did you meet any Filipino backpacker there? No.
Actually, no.
Majority were Europeans, I suppose. No.
Also Latin Americans backpackers.
Okay.
So
okay.
People from their own Latin America, like Argentinians, Chileans traveling in the north, Mexicans traveling in the south. So all of them also. But of course, you met a lot of people from the States, Europe, Australia, some Asians. That's the people that you meet the more of them.
Yeah. But so, what was your most important learning during those 10 months? What really would you, as you look back, what was your most important learning or most life-changing experience maybe?
For me, it was actually breaking prejudice, the fear that you normally have for not traveling or not having experiences, to break all of that in my mind. It really opens you. It really gives you more perspective about how the world actually works. And it's not just in your little bubble of your little town of Spain, but you always, you know, you're always influenced by these European values and thoughts. It's pretty nice also, but is the fact that you don't really get close to other realities in the world. Like you're really involved in this European and Spanish values and environment where you feel very comfortable and everything, but you're not close of what is going on out there. So my experience in America Latina, it really broke that bubble. It really opened my mind to understand other realities, other people's different ways of thinking, and that's something that really changed your mind. So I think for me that was the most important experience on my trip.
Yeah. Well, and your course was social work and psychology that you took to really go into international cooperation in that field. No? But what inspired you why that choice of course or degree in college, and what inspired you to really try to develop a career in international cooperation?
It's difficult to say actually, because I can say that when I was younger, I was a person who was always hearing. I was more hearing person than Dr. Keith. So I suppose I was the referent person of my friends whenever they had an issue or a problem. I was the one they came to tell their problem. So I was, I started helping people around me, friends, stuff like that.
Just by listening to them,
So I started feeling close to people and starting to be curious about why people were suffering from different kind of things, stress, anxiety, or daily life issues. So I think that what's brought me to psychology, to really understand people's mind. And I think for international cooperation, when I started to research, investigate a little bit more about how the world actually works, no? How is other realities, I was very moved by injustice. I was very moved by the fact that look what all we have here in Europe or in Spain are on the lack of resources or food or other kind of things you may find in other countries. Mm. And I think it opens your eyes, kind of, and it really, for me, it moved me a lot, and it really made me feel like if I want to do something in life, it has to be something related to social work that is going to make maybe not change itself, no? Because, of course, what I do is a very little thing comparing with what's going on in the world, but at least be part of that change, no? Mm-hmm. In the way that it was in my hand. So for me, I think that movement of understanding other people's feelings and to move by this injustice and try to make something in that way was to move me to psychologists and then international cooperation.
Mm, yeah, very, very interesting. It's actually a very interesting combination, no?
Yes.
Because, you know, also very often when you take a look at people who do social work or people who do, well, development work, no, more than social work, really, your field is more development work, international cooperation, development work. You know, I find that they are more on the technical side, no, rather than the psychological person-to-person side, no? Because that's a rather good combination, actually, no, because when you go, and I'm sure we'll ask you to share your experiences here in the Philippines, but I'm sure when you go to communities, your orientation towards psychology helps a lot, no, in terms of observing people, listening to people, understanding their context, you know. So how about here in the Philippines, what has your experience been so far, no? So
That's absolutely true. Actually, my mind is always in the psychology perspective, and there is a lack of funds and projects focused on that. You can see nowadays people are suffering a lot from stress, anxiety, burnout. We also are starting to be more, we feel more lonely. No, we are more connected. We have all this media, or we have, look, we can live in Manila, no, surrounded by millions of people, but you still can feel lonely and distant, and this is an issue that the society is generating basically in the current system, no? And I think that there is a psychological issues that we are forgetting whenever we are in whatever we are building, whatever society we are building here. There is a lack of focus on mental health and psychology aspects. So it's something that you don't actually only find in the communities, which actually I find less issues in communities than in the town, no? in the modern society. Mm-hmm. But maybe we are suffering more from our daily lives. So I'm very sensitive with these needs, not only in the communities, as I was mentioning, but also with my work colleagues, with my family, with my friends, people surrounding me. I think it's something that I always have in consideration. But of course, whenever there is, as you know, because of my work, our work, Father, we are very related to disaster.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
You know, there is disaster can be in so many ways. No, that could be typhoons.
As they say, David, it could be a natural or a man-made disaster. No,
exactly.
There is like the work that you visited in Bangladesh, right? That was a man-made disaster. No, so
yeah, that was huge. Yeah, the Rohingyans issues of the Rohingya community living in Myanmar that was displaced, and now they're in a refugee camp in Bangladesh. In Cox Bazar. This is a humanitarian tragedy. And this, you can find other different kind of strategies at different level. But of course, this is affecting people. And you can give resources, you can give a house, you can give give food. But, you know, there are psychological issues of what was my life, what is my current life, what is my life expectation now, what I'm going to do like myself, where I'm going to get a job, where is the future of my children, in so many different contexts. There is a psychological mental issues that the current projects are not that focused on. Caritas is actually doing a great job in the Philippines, because from the parishes, they normally have psychological support to the communities affected by different kind of disasters. But it is not common to find. So I think it's something that really, really needs to be more present in projects and in people's minds.
That's an interesting point, David, no? Because normally when you do development work, your metrics are always either an economic, diba, metrics and all that. When you say how do you better the lives of people, it's always in terms of services, diba? Do they have water? Do they have electricity, housing, etc., food security? But very little really, or more can be done in terms of the psychological part, you know, the mental well-being, no? So. And in fact, we attend meetings of Caritas Philippines. I see you there very often. And I like the word that they use. I don't know if you notice, a term that they use consistently is accompaniment. Accompaniment, no? I think that's a beautiful word, no? Accompaniment. It's really journeying with people, no? So
that's very important, because it means that you are not doing anything for else. It means that you accompany them to make sure that they are the one who are empowered, who they are the one who develop their resilience enough to overcome those situations. So it's not about to give them everything they need, because then you generate dependence. No, they need more every time they just waste what you gave. So it's more about to accompany on the process to make sure that whatever they achieve is by themselves and they can sustain and keep it for their own knowledge and capacitation in order to be more resilient next time something happens. And this is also part of the psychology. And I think the resilience is very important to be associated also with the psychological capacities of us adapt to the new realities and be able to go on even if the situation is in the worst of the scenarios.
Especially when you deal with the disasters, you know, that's really very important in the perhaps you could share more, David, on your work here in the Philippines, your current projects in the Philippines now, no?
Yes, our main role as a Caritas Spain is actually to accompany the work of Caritas Philippines. We accompany the institutional development, but of course, all the needs that they find in their different DISACs and community areas of the Philippines.
Yeah, that, maybe just for our viewers, the DISAC is the Diocesan Social Action Center. Each diocese, which there are 85 in the Philippines, each diocese would have a social action center. So that's what we call the DSACs. Go ahead, David. Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. No, thank you for the clarification. That's right. We are used to use these words, no? That's why we are not used to clarify what the meaning. Yes, every DSAC is the social arm, no, of the church in the local communities. And they're very close to the communities, and this is very easy for them to identify the needs of the communities. This is transferred to Caritas Philippines, and it's Caritas Philippines the one who let us know also what are the needs in the different communities. So we try also to help them to identify those needs and to get funds in order to cover those needs by different kind of projects that the community is the one, or I think this is very important. The participation of the community is basic here, and they are the one who actually let us know how do we have to resolve their issues.
Okay.
And that's what we actually do. We go on field, we understand what they need. They tell us how to do it, and we try to find the funds in order to develop the projects that they need in order to I don't know, like to overcome any kind of situation that can be improving their measures, improving livelihood stock, improving governance or also education related. So it can be different kind of areas. Actually, right now we are supporting with four different projects in different areas. We are in North Luzon, we are supporting in Visayas, we are supporting in Mindanao. Not only development, but also emergencies. So we are still supporting a project for the Goni in the Bicol region.
Yeah.
And also we are supporting projects for the Odet. So very, very different kind of lines of intervention, and always accompany and following the strategy of Caritas Philippines.
Yeah, and you are also, in fact, I will be joining you in the trip, no, to Mindanao, no, and that's to explore more areas of cooperation, no, in Mindanao.
Absolutely. I think, as you all very well know, Mindanao is a very affected area by different kind of issues. No, it's not only the kind of typhoons, but you also have like culturals, religions issues that hasn't been resolved. You have the Marawi conflict where you still can't find people that hasn't been able to go back home after the war. There are different kind of issues that needs to be addressed. Actually, in this trip, as you very well said, we are also bringing people from the Spanish Agency of Cooperation to show them the reality of Mindanao and to explain them what is the needs that the current community is actually suffering, in order to put the focus also on those communities and, of course, try to get funds to support the work of the local communities. And
those funds will come from the Spanish government, right?
Yes, not only the Spanish government, which is our main funder, but also from different regions. There is also local governments from Spain. Are also like supporting different kind of projects. They're actually very focused on international cooperation. But of course, you also have European Union and sometimes also private companies that are very happy to support this kind of projects.
So, David, what is your what would be your final words of wisdom, especially for young people who are thinking of doing development work or doing even volunteer work? No, and oh, by the way, before we go to that. You're also starting a volunteer work, no, for some of your students, no, or
how is that? We are starting a program also in the Philippines to bring volunteers from different places of Spain in order for them to get to know the reality of the Philippines. Mm-hmm. We think the heritage connection of the Philippines and Spain is huge, no, like for 500 years since Magallanes arrived in the Philippines, there is a very beautiful links that we maintain nowadays in between the Philippines and Spain, and we think it's very important also to bring this reality to Spain. So a part of bringing all the pictures, videos, and testimonies that we come from the Philippines to Spain, we also try to bring people from Spain here to the Philippines for months, 2 months, in order to experience and live the reality, you know, of what is going on in the Philippines through experience.
Okay, then we look forward to that. Maybe we can invite when they're done with their volunteer work, we can invite them to guest here, no? Just to share what they went through, no? Okay, David, any final words of advice or wisdom to young people who might be thinking of either going into psychology or social work or international cooperation?
Well, what I would say is, like, actually, you don't need to be specialized in these fields in order to support or make any change. I think anyone can participate as a volunteer, can donate, or can make something in order to make the difference. Of course, those that want to be part of the social work, I totally encourage, because it's a very good way of spending your lifetime in a very good job that is making others people's life change. But I also encourage other kind of people that are not actually related to this work to also, you know, like to get close, to understand what is going on, and to try to support in their ways that is possible. So that's going to be my message.
Yeah. So thank you very much, and we look forward to that, David. We look forward to that interview with your volunteers when they end their time here in the Philippines. Let's guest them here so they can share their experiences. No,
of course we will do it. Thank you. Thanks to you for calling me and give me the space to share my experience.
Yeah, thank you very much. And we hope to feature some of your projects also here in the Philippines in the future. So again, all the best, and I hope you have two more years or 3 years in the Philippines.
Two more years.
So we hope that it will be very fruitful years. Again, thank you very much, David, and to all our viewers, marami pong salamat. And you might want to say goodbye in Spanish, David.
Muchas gracias a todos. Seguramente muchos me puedan entender porque el español se hablaba aquí. Y bueno, gracias por haber visto el programa, por haberlo entendido. Y bueno, nos vemos pronto. Gracias, padre.
Gracias, David. Thank you.